This week on The Pier, we dip into the world of rock stardom and rock musicianship. Mark King, formerly of the chart-topping band Level 42, is widely considered to be the best bass guitarist of his generation. We tracked him down to the Isle of Wight, where he lives, and was in fact born, to find he's on the verge of a solo career. We start this film with a bit of an indulgence. Check out the fingerwork on this. For many, Level 42 were just a pop group, but to fans and those in the music business, they were also one of the most respected bands in the industry for sheer musicianship. For Mark King, it was a typical rags-to-riches tale. He worked as a milkman on the Isle of Wight while playing drums in a couple of local bands. It took a move to London and a unique style of bass playing before success showed itself. Level 42 played up to 100 gigs a year, many in top European venues. They even opened for Madonna. The band's now split, and Mark King, at 37, is going solo.
I'm going to see if I can pick up a deal with one of the major labels for putting out the new album. Now, this is a second sort of option for me, really, because I'm also quite keen to see the project through in its entirety on my own. The downside of that option is that you don't have the weight, the clout that a record company can offer in terms of promotion. So I'm keen to get up to town now to see if I can find a sympathetic major label that might be interested in getting on board, really.
It's just natural to him to pick up instruments just to play. He has a tremendous amount to say, and I don't think we've seen the half of it yet. I think that now he's working on a solo project. This will finally give him a chance to really blossom.
The really remarkable thing about him as a musician is that he's entertaining, talking about things other than himself. He's the pop star that you would send to meet your mother and know that your mother would be enormously impressed with him.
Ride, where we are sitting now, used to boast three or four great venues for bands to be playing. So you could have a choice of three or four bands on per night in any one place. And it was something that I noticed when I finally did come back to the island in 1988, after being in London for 10 years or so, was that so many of the venues had gone and there was no sort of grassroots way for young musicians to really be, you know, performing and doing things. And that's all any kid needs, is for someone to get excited with them on their behalf about what it is. Here, you know, at Cowes High School, there was Graham Holmes, who was fantastically enthusiastic for you.
I think that he was at a superior level because he could rearrange traditional sounds in a new way, and therefore produced a new sound. And any new composer, any new group, searches for something new.
All I ever wanted to be was a drummer. I can remember at nine, you know, the first time that the crowd absolutely loved that I did this drum solo. And it was such a phenomenal feeling of having an audience respond to something that you did, that I can remember after the concert,
which was at Carisbrook High School at the time. It would have been called secondary modern school, I suppose, then. So getting home at about 6 o'clock in the evening after the concert and lying in front of the fire, because my dad was saying, wow, that nipper stole the show. Wasn't he great, Bridget? That's my mum. And I just sat there all night saying, oh, it was really good, wasn't it? How great was I? Wasn't it great? And so, you know, sadly began this terrible ego massaging trip that I've been on ever since. But it was wonderful, you know, to have the mum and dad that support you like that. You know, I was lucky enough, but by the time I was 11, I had, when we were over at my granny's house one day, Annie and Martin Cave dropped by, and they were in a group called Pseudo Foot, a real group. That's a great name, isn't it? Pseudo Foot. And I'd sat in with them on a talent show one afternoon at a holiday camp. And they remember this, and when their drummer left, they came and said, did I want to join? So I was really lucky to be able to join a working group, a serious group, doing covers, of course. And then the most amazing experience is by my mum and dad had bought a new TV, and in sort of pushing the wrong button, I changed over to BBC Two and saw the Mahavishnu Orchestra in concert with John McLaughlin on guitar. And he had this twin neck guitar, and he was dressed all in white, and he had short hair, and he looked incredibly spiritual-like. And it was just absolutely mind-blowing. They weren't bothered, they weren't fanning around with things like singing. They'd just gone on and played, but the most incredible music. Maybe only a year after this, the Mahavishnu Orchestra, and its second incantation, and we were doing a show over in Portsmouth, at Portsmouth Guildhall. And I really couldn't sort of get any friends that were interested in that kind of thing. But I got on this ferry and I saw a couple of dudes with big parkas on, with like Gentle Giant written on and stuff. And actually turned out, latterly, about a year after that, I became friends with them, and that turned out to be Phil Gould and Boone Gould. You know, as we got older, I think I got to 18 or 19 years of age. I'd moved to London with the old milk van that I used to drive around. That was very nice. I bought for 35 quid an old Dormabil. I mean, my impression of London was that it was just going to be absolutely chock-a-block full of the most amazing musicians. When you did go into the music shops, that far from seeing anyone famous, you know, you got the bum's rush from the staff. Being rude, it's quite to see I specialise in, so I ended up getting a job in a music shop. And that was okay. I sort of worked there for a year or so. But in the meantime, Phil Gould had moved up to London and was studying at the Royal Academy of Music. He was doing it a much better way, really. So he was being able to study music all the time and was getting a grant for doing it. And then Boone moved up to London, not to a music college or anything, but very much like myself, just on the off chance of something happening. And we didn't go up together at all, but we did meet up in London. And Phil introduced us to Mike Lindup, who was a guy that he met who was studying at the Guildhall School of Music as a percussionist.
I met Mark for the first time on Oxford Street, and I'd just bought a pair of Billy Cobham drumsticks, because there were three drummers in the band at that time, so we were all... That was kind of our meeting point, was talking about, you know, who's the best drummer and, you know, whose licks do you want to copy and that kind of thing.
We got on very well. And after, you know, a period of time where we were doing nothing together at all, really, it sort of transpired that in 1979, we did get together and jam at the Guildhall School of Music. Mike sort of fixed us to have a room of a Monday evening. And... We didn't sort of have any set instruments. The fact that Phil was up there and was playing drums and he had his drum kit more or less meant that, well, he was going to be doing the drums then, you know. And he was a fantastic drummer anyway, so that, you know, that was sort of taking care of itself in that respect. Mike, his second instrument at college was piano, so he was playing keyboards.
And Mark was getting into the bass then, having played a bit of guitar and, you know, really sort of went for the kind of thumb style.
The Americans were playing what was called slap bass, which is they were using their thumb, not all of them, but, you know, the sort of some players were using their thumb to play in a percussive manner, as opposed to what we'd all recognise as just being bass, which is sort of quite fundamental, sort of chugging along in this way. The idea of actually playing it percussively so that you could play notes, but you were actually
doing much more of a rhythm, just like you would on the drums, you know, so you'd start. But this sort of thing became, was easy for me to do, it was easy to perceive, you know, and okay, I didn't have the drums, but I had the bass. The notes sort of would come along later, so I was, you know, forced to drum on something else, really. Okay, the drumming comes in because you use two hands. Now that means that instead of just plucking the notes with this hand, and by plucking it you'll hear the note, I can actually hammer on with this hand. And so I can play notes with this hand without doing anything. Look, I can do anything with this hand. I don't really have to use this hand. So this one can start becoming the rhythmic thing. So if I get like bass drum and snare, like, so that way you start getting this sort of this linear rolling motion of quite an interesting percussive passage. Then you can start increasing the fills and things that you might want to put in a line like that. You can start doing the things that, the things that a drummer would do, you can start putting in triplets. And it's not as if what hand is this? It's left, right. My right hand is going particularly fast. I'm not sort of suddenly going, I'm actually playing it between the two hands as a drummer would do. So, I might do something like this. And so on.
And it was Andy Soiker who came along, who had this idea of, well, this is kind of jazz funk thing happening. If I can get these guys to sort of fit in with that, then, you know, that'll be a kind of a lift. And that was kind of our first audience.
He chose one riff that we had at the time that he said, yeah, that will make a good tune, you know, that will make a good song. He said, if you can get someone to sing on this, it just so happened that this is one that I was playing bass on. Boone was on guitar, Phil was on drums, Mike was on piano. And it was very much a walking bass line, which became the basis.
Andy Soiker had said, well, you know, perhaps you can try singing it yourselves, or I can get a singer in. And he got in somebody to do a kind of demo vocal. And we listened to it and we hated it.
And this was our band. I'm getting some Herbert to come in and take all the glory.
And so Mark said, you know, I kind of, you know, wrote most of the melody, I'll have a go at singing. And so he did, and it sounded good.
And that became Love Meeting Love, which Andy Soiker put out on his Elite Records label. And it seemed to really kick in. Summer nights, making love. A bigger break came for us when we recorded Love Games for Polydor. And this was one where I was now starting to use the thumb. And that riff sort of was very... That became a thing that became famous for us because it was the thumb seemed to be in, and the fact that I was singing it again. It just seemed sort of quite different. And I think that the Brit funk movement, as it was now being known, found that they had, a champion band. And it got us a shot on Top of the Pops, and it was all, really exciting at the time. By 1985, we'd sort of reached a point where we did sit down. I can remember it sort of early in 85, and we said, you know, we're going to do another album. We really need to try and break this pattern that we're in of releasing a record, selling, say, 60,000 albums, having one hit, one sort of minor hit on the record, and then just sort of touring here and touring in sort of local Europe. We needed to have a big hit single, so we came up with Something About You. We only had the two singles off of the World Machine album. But because we were on a very good roll with writing, we came up with Lessons in Love, which was going to be from the next album, the Running in the Family album. And we were never here when the record was sort of a hit. I can remember getting sort of calls from the manager, Crockford, saying, "Guys, number three this week." I said, "God, this is amazing." You know, and the next week, "Oh, I stayed at number three. What a bugger." You know, and then the week after that, "No, it's still number three." "Oh, damn it." You know, I mean, I couldn't believe it was staying there. It was a shame it didn't go any higher. And then when it went over into Europe and it came out in Germany, it sort of went to number one, and it was number one for 7 weeks. This is all just incredible stuff. Well, come 88 and 89, you know, we'd gone through the upheaval of first Boone leaving the band, then Phil leaving the band. Once again, with hindsight, it would have perhaps been better to have knocked the band on the head and then to have gone our separate ways and carried on, you know, with a fresh thing. But, you know, we were trying to sort of step into new territories there. And at the time, I wanted to carry on with the Love of 42 thing, as indeed did Mike. So we were lucky enough to draft in Gary Husband on drums and Alan Murphy on guitar.
I wanted to join because it was a great challenge. You know, a great challenge to... and also I wanted to play some music for a while that was accessible. I wanted to be involved with something that was a little more immediate for a change. And also, you know, I love song form. I love songs, which is why, you know, the getting involved in the writing was such a good thing for me. It was a logical thing, because I loved it, you know, and I loved the challenge of it, you know, saying something through a song.
And that was a fantastic time, because we were being successful. You know, we had in guys that were great players that were contributing a lot. And, of course, the direction was going to change. It was going to go the way that it would have gone with two new members in and, you know, everybody chipping in their ideas. And then, sadly, Al Murphy died in 89. And that was a real blow, because up to then, nothing had been anything like as important as this. Nothing had been as final as losing, you know, a close friend, you know, and a workmate and somebody who was sort of inspiring to be around. Nothing would be the same after that event. You know, we could keep going, but having already been through the band change with Boone and then Phil, and now having what you thought was going to be the next chapter sort of torn away from you, you almost sort of start switching to autopilot a little bit, in a way, in that, well, we've got to make another album, we will be making another album, because that's what we have done for all these last years, so you sort of get on and do it. That's not to say that, I didn't enjoy making the records. I'm only saying, with the luxury of hindsight, that's, you know, because at the time, you only ever get on and do what you can do at the time, and you can't sit down and, sort of kill yourself about it. You just get on and do the best you can.
Differences over the group's next album, Guaranteed, prompted a move to a different label. Their final album, Forever Now, was released in 1994 and was followed by a short tour.
When we finished the tour, Mike and I thought, you know, this thing's run its course, really. Certainly for now. It's not to say that in the years to come that we won't sort of, you know, do something else. If you sort of wonder what I'm up to these days,
Well, I'm making a solo record. The fact that I'm doing it all on my own is really just a case of it's easiest to do it that way. The technology is around and makes it available for you to sit down and to play keyboards really quite well. And it's nice for me to be able to sort of to play drums on something that I'm doing for once, and play some bass, and get my jollies playing some guitar parts. I have to put in a guide track first of all, but it'll be incredibly simplistic. Then I'll go in there and thrash 7 bangs out of the drums. So when I've been sat here, I've really tried to bear in mind that you know, the excitement that can be gleaned from how is this sort of bit of music striking me now? So pretending, really, that I'm playing it and sort of with other musicians. And it works quite well, you know. Everybody that I've played the stuff to seem to think, God, you know, it sounds like it's a real band playing, isn't it? And it's not easy to do that. I want to get back to doing the live shows. That's the best thing there is, really. That's when you don't have to justify anything that you do other than get up on stage and say, look, this is what I do, you know, this is what this band's about, and this is what this current moment in my career is about, you know, and I'm glad you like the stuff I did before. I hope you like the stuff I'm doing now. And if you don't, well, come back and see me next time, because there'll be something else happening.